Gildan Audio presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable life-changing seminars on CD. Step up to success in business and in life. You can achieve your dreams. Written and read by Nido Qubein.
Hello, I'm Nido Qubein, and I want to help you step up to success. If you follow through these sessions, you'll learn the 6 steps to successful living. You'll learn to dream about success, plan for success, and act towards success. You'll learn to choose the career in which you can find the most success and happiness. And you'll learn to achieve success in all your roles in life, in your family, your community, in your business, in whatever endeavor you find yourself. I found the path myself, with the help of many good and wise men and women along the way. I started as a young immigrant from the Middle East. I came to this country with no more than $50 in my pocket and not nearly that many English words in my vocabulary. For a person looking toward a career in business and in communication, I gotta tell you, I had to make quite a climb. But I envisioned a stairway to success. And I climbed it to heights I only dreamed of as a young person. What I have accomplished is no more than what you can accomplish. I promise you that. All you need to do is learn the 6 steps to success and then start walking them one by one. I want to share with you some of the secrets I've learned along the way. I've traveled 5 continents on business and pleasure. Everywhere I've gone, I've encountered people pursuing a common quest. Success. Everybody wants to be successful. Many come to me in search of a secret formula. They've labored for years, butting their heads against walls and suffering failure and rejection. Still they wonder, is it possible for me to achieve success? Especially given my level of talent and education? And I have a ready response for all of them. My response is this: you can if you want to. You see, success is not a matter of luck. It doesn't spring from an accident of birth. It's not a reward for virtue. It results from taking 6 steps that you have complete control over. Those steps are these: decision, commitment, planning, preparation, execution, and then recommitment. Decision, commitment, planning, preparation, execution, and recommitment. It's important for you to realize this. Success does not come to you. You must go to it. The trail is well traveled. The trail is well marked. If you want to walk it, yes, you can. If you listen carefully to these tapes, they will help you find the right steps. A lot of people tell me, you've got to have talent to be successful. Well, they're right. But you see, everyone has talent. Michael Jordan's talent is bouncing a basketball down the court and plopping it through a round hoop. That's how he made it to superstardom. When he tried baseball, though, you remember this, when he tried baseball, he had to go down to the minor leagues. Henry Ford's talent was building automobiles. He wouldn't have made it as the CEO of an insurance company. But when it came to engineering and manufacturing automobiles, he had great talent. You see, some people are talented at driving nails, some at shaping clay. Some are good at speaking before audiences, some are better at writing novels. Some excel at skating, some at dancing, some are skilled at sewing, some at cooking, some are good at organizing things, some are good at doing things. My point is this: everyone is talented. You are talented. We're just talented in different ways. If you want to succeed, identify the areas in which you are talented, then commit to developing those talents to the fullest. Yes, you can do it if you want to. The secret is in the 6 steps I mentioned earlier. You might want to write them down somewhere, so let me name them for you again. Step 1 is decision. Decide what you want in life. Make it a decision that comes from deep inside of you. This means getting to know yourself. Identify the things you do well and the things you enjoy doing. Get familiar with the way you respond to people and events and why you respond that way. Learn where you're strong and play to your strengths. When you've defined yourself, you can also define the success you want, and you can begin the journey toward your dreams. Step 2 is commitment. It's one thing to decide what you want. It's another thing to make a commitment. A commitment is like your signature on a contract. It binds you to a course of action. When you make a deep commitment to a goal, powerful forces come into play, propelling you toward that goal. The power comes from within you. It's there, and you may not even know it. Step 3 is planning. Here is where one three-letter word separates losers from winners. That word is how. Losers ask, can I do it? Winners ask, how can I do it? You see, losers are guided by what's impossible. They see barriers and they stop in their tracks. Winners are guided by what's possible. They see possibilities and they go for them. By devising a strategy one possibility at a time, they achieve their goals. Step 4, preparation. Once you know where you want to go, you begin preparing yourself for the journey. To prepare, you must acquire balance so that you can stay on course. You must be balanced in 5 areas of your life. They are the physical, mental, emotional, social, and spiritual dimensions. Preparation also means obtaining the motivation to take you where you want to go. Step 5 is execution. Executing your life's plan involves 3 phases: acting, learning, and applying. A good coach knows that it's not enough to have a game plan. You have to put it into action on the field. It's the same with your own life action plan. As you act, you'll make mistakes, but then we all do. So to succeed, you must look for ways to learn from your mistakes. You'll never know whether a particular action will be successful until you've tried it. But once you've tried it, you can observe the results. This will tell you what works, and this will tell you what doesn't work. Winners expect to make mistakes, but they use them as lessons. They apply what they learn toward implementing the plan. And step 6 is recommitment. When you've achieved the last goal in your action plan, don't stop. Your life is not at an end. You're, in fact, at a new beginning. Successful people know that life is a process that unfolds continuously, and they remain in control of the unfolding. When they reach that long-sought plateau, they immediately create their new next vision. They move on to new plateaus, making new decisions and making new commitments. They plan, they prepare, they execute until the new vision is achieved. So you might say success builds upon success. If you follow these 6 steps, you will succeed. Not because there's magic in the formula, but because there's power in you. You have the power to accomplish whatever you want to accomplish. And with the help of God, if you want to, you can do it. Sound simple? Well, it really is simple. So relax and enjoy the view of your new future as we move step by step toward success. That's what this program is all about, to walk you step by step until you can make your future come to be. Let's start now with step 1, your decision. Your route to success begins with a simple question. What do you want to do? You've heard that question often. You come home Friday evening and your partner asks, what do you want to do this weekend? And you shrug and say, I don't know, what do you want to do? Since neither of you is willing to make a decision, you end up doing nothing in particular, and before you know it, it's Monday again, and all you've accomplished is getting the Sunday paper read. Perhaps you heard the question when you were in high school. Maybe you are on summer break and your best friend asked, "What do you want to do?" And you shrugged and said, "I don't know. What do you want to do?" And because neither of you came up with an answer, you spent the summer goofing off. Soon it was time to go back to school, and you had little to show for the summer except perhaps a sunburn. Many people let their early adulthood slip away in just this way. They party through their 20s, drifting from one good time to another. They never really answer the question, "What do you want to do?" Then suddenly they're facing their 30th birthdays, or 35th, or 40th, and they begin to feel the weight of responsibility. They know they can't keep drifting through life. They have families and mortgages and orthodontist bills. They have to do something with their lives. But the question is, what? The earlier you confront that question, the better it will be for you. But here's the good news. It's never too late. Whether you're 18 or 80, you can decide what you want to do with the rest of your life. And you can begin doing it now. The first step is the decision. If you're a young person, don't think that you have to give up all the good times for the daily grind of work and study. You reach success by finding a happy balance between work and pleasure. In fact, truly successful people make their work a part of their pleasure. They decide what they want from life. Then they choose careers that help them find what they want and have fun at the same time. They base their career choices on what they enjoy doing, not on what they have to do. Sometimes people ask me, "Nido, what is success?" The truth is, I can't answer that question for you. You have to answer that question for yourself. No one else can define success for you. For Donald Trump, success meant making lots of money. For Ted Turner, it meant building a media empire that could challenge the major networks. For Albert Einstein, it meant unraveling the secrets of the universe. For Henry Aaron, it meant surpassing Babe Ruth's record of 714 lifetime home runs. But mind you, for Mother Teresa, it meant helping the poor people of India. What will it take to make you feel successful? You won't really succeed unless the things you accomplish bring you pleasure and satisfaction. What good would it be if you won a cruise to the Caribbean, yet you hated sunshine and you were afraid of water? How thrilled would you be over being elected to your state legislature if you hated politics? How excited would you be over a promotion to sales manager if your real interest lay in research and development? You see, you begin your climb to success by deciding what success means for you. You lay the foundation for that decision by asking three questions. The first one is this: what am I good at? The second question: what do I enjoy doing? And the third question: what values are really important to me? You'll find success when you're doing something you're good at. You'll find success when you're enjoying what you're doing and when those things support your important values. So let's begin with the first question. What am I good at? Many people go through life without thinking seriously about what they really do well. I've known talented writers who lived out their lives as clerical workers. It never occurred to them that they might become novelists or journalists or speechwriters. I've known people who were great natural communicators. They could speak clearly, simply, forcefully. Their talents might have carried them into television or some other exciting communication career, yet they spent their lives as cab drivers. I've known people with minds like calculators, yet they spent their lives on assembly lines instead of in finance departments. I've even known people who could paint lifelike portraits. But did they become successful artists? Oh no. They spent their days behind sales counters instead of in front of easels. Now please, don't get me wrong. There's nothing wrong with being a clerical worker or assembly line worker or a cab driver or a sales clerk. If that's what you like to do and it's what you do well, then go for it. But too many people drift into these jobs because they're the first things available. They get stuck in them because they never realize the market value of their talents. I've had people come to me and say, "I wish I were talented." And I always tell them, "You are talented." You see, everyone is talented in something. Don't let anyone convince you otherwise. Your own estimate of your abilities is the most important estimate. So identify your strong points. Give them the recognition they deserve and use them to do what you like to do. Many people are wrongly convinced that they're not talented. They look at talent too narrowly. They think of talent as being able to sing or dance or compose poetry. They figure that talented people are those who can carve statues, design buildings, or at least write software programs. So if they can't do any of these things, they think they're simply untalented. But talent can come in many forms. It takes one type of talent to drive a big rig. It takes another type to play a piano. It takes still another type to program a computer, another to write a novel. Stop and think about the things you like to do and the things that you do well. What is your strongest ability? Notice that I asked, what is your strongest ability? I didn't ask, what are you brilliant at doing? You don't have to be brilliant to be successful. People with seemingly ordinary gifts have made extraordinary contributions to society. The secret lies in determining where your strengths lie, then focusing those strengths on your objectives. Focusing is simply a way of mobilizing and concentrating power. Let me give you an example. The water in a steam boiler has no more potential than the water in your bathtub. But when that water in the steam boiler is energized and focused, what happens? It can turn turbines, power locomotives, and drive the wheels of industry. The water in your bathtub is unfocused and non-energized. It just goes down the drain. If your particular talents remain unfocused and non-energized, all your potential goes down the drain. But if you're focused and energized, you could become another Harry Truman or Dwight Eisenhower, or you might become an Eleanor Roosevelt or Margaret Mitchell. To paraphrase Thomas Wolfe, the great North Carolina novelist, Thomas Wolfe said, "If you have a talent and can't use it, you failed. If you have a talent and use only half of it, you've partly failed. But if you have a talent and learn to use it to the fullest, you have gloriously succeeded. And you have won a satisfaction and a triumph few people ever know." So, my friend, identify your talent and decide to use it in exciting, rewarding ways. Take a pen and pad to a quiet, comfortable place. Relax and let your mind go back over the things you've done and done very well. It may be a term paper you wrote in 8th grade. It may be a 10th grade science project or a dollhouse you built for your daughter. It may be a project you headed up for your company or a sales presentation you prepared and delivered. What talents did you make use of in accomplishing these things? Write them down and grade them. Which of these talents do you regard as your strongest? Keep that list handy. It will help you as you walk the 6 steps to success. The 6 steps that I'll unveil for you step by step with great detail throughout this program. Now that we've examined the question, what am I good at? Let's move to the question, what do I enjoy doing? The two questions, mind you, are closely related because we usually enjoy doing what we do well. You're most likely to succeed in a career that makes the best use of your talents and provides you with personal satisfaction. Remember that list you made of your strongest talents? Now think about the ways you enjoy applying those talents. To determine what activities give you the most satisfaction, ask yourself some questions. What do I do that gives me the greatest sense of accomplishment? What do I do that gives me the greatest feeling of pride? What do I do that gives me the greatest feeling of confidence? And if I had a year to spend doing anything I wanted to, what would I do? take some time on these questions. Let your mind wander over them during your more relaxed moments. Daydream about the things you would do if you could do whatever you wanted to do. To be completely happy in your work, you have to look beyond your talents and your likes. You also have to consider the type of behavior the role will require of you. It stands to reason that you will be happiest and most successful in roles that allow you to be yourself. This means responding to people, events, and circumstances in a way that is most natural and most comfortable for you. It isn't quite enough to find something you do well and like to do. You must also look for roles that let you behave in ways that make you comfortable. Let me tell you what I mean. If you're good at business management, you may be in your element when you're plotting sales and marketing strategy. But you may be uncomfortable when you have to discipline subordinates. And you may be miserable when you have to fire them. Others may find it stimulating to deal with human relations problems. They may take hiring and firing decisions in stride as a part of the normal routine of management. Therefore, in choosing your roles in life, it's helpful to look at the normal way you respond to people and events. Some people are natural, take-charge individuals. They enjoy setting broad policy, giving others their marching orders, and letting subordinates attend to the details. For them, winning is the principal motivation. They'll do whatever is necessary to win, without regard to whether this makes them popular or unpopular. Others enjoy the admiration and friendship of others. They're great at organizing group activities and at interacting with other people. They hate lonely tasks. Wherever they go, they like to be the life of the party and the center of attraction. They love to win, and they can be devastated by public criticism or failure. Still others, you and I know, want most to be liked by other people. They'll go to great lengths to accommodate the wishes of others. They dislike conflict, and they are uncomfortable when they have to discipline or reprimand. They like stability and they hate change. But they get along well with others, so long as others show them the proper appreciation. Finally, we find people who would rather be right than popular. These are the meticulous people who believe in doing things right or not at all. They're guided by their own inner standards. They often feel more comfortable working with objects and figures than they do working with people. Which of these descriptions best fits you? Knowing yourself in this way can guide you in your choice of careers. Suppose you enjoy sports and you have good athletic ability. You also enjoy working with young people. Based on these factors, you think you might enjoy a career as an athletic coach. But you're one of those people who value security, dislike personal conflict, and have a strong desire to be liked by others. Think about how these preferences would affect your performance as a coach. A coach's job security often depends upon the ability to turn out winning teams year after year after year. Yet your principal motivation is not winning, but being liked. Can you stretch beyond your preferred mode and become aggressive and assertive when necessary? Can you live with the insecurity of knowing that one mediocre season could send you back into the job market? When an athlete has worked her heart out to make the squad, can you tell her that she didn't make the cut? Could you discipline the hotshot player who thinks he can run the team better than you can? You may face situations such as these that will require you to step outside your most comfortable behavior. As you consider your role in life, keep in mind your preferred style of behavior. Think about the extent to which you will have to stretch beyond it to achieve success. Decide whether you can make the stretch without running into an unacceptable level of stress or even distress. Then make your choice. Let's say that you've identified a career that lets you do what you like and what you do well. You've found a comfortable role in that career. Good. Now you need to ask one other important question. What are your values in life, and how might they affect your choice of career? That's what we'll be discussing. We'll learn how to separate the doable from the impossible, We'll learn to distinguish between the urgent and the important. We'll learn to focus on the things that really matter to us. And we'll find out how to concentrate our time, energy, and talents where they are most effective. In our first session, we learned to identify the things you do best and the things you most enjoy doing. We've learned to use those two criteria to select a career and a role that you will find enjoyable and comfortable. But true success goes far beyond a career choice. History is full of examples of people whose careers soared while their lives crashed. They became failures even as they were doing the things they enjoyed and did best. This can happen if your behavior is not guided by dependable rules of conduct. To be dependable, these rules must be based on a set of principles. These principles must be based on positive, personal values. You can write your own rules based on the principles you choose and the values you cherish. Let's stop to define what we mean. A value is something you hold dear. A principle is a broad, fundamental truth. A rule of conduct is a guide to behavior designed to put a principle into action. Let me give you an example. Human life is a value. Suppose I say, it's wrong to take human life deliberately and maliciously. I have stated a principle based upon that value. And when I say, thou shalt not commit murder, I'm stating a rule of conduct. So, a value is something that you hold dear, like human life is a value. A principle is a broad fundamental truth, like it is wrong to take human life deliberately and maliciously. And a rule of conduct is a guide to behavior designed to put a principle into action, like thou shalt not commit murder. The principle supports the value. The rule puts the principle into action. Of course, different people value different things. You may view some values as negative and some as positive. Some people value generosity, kindness, and decency. Others value greed, violence, and obscenity. What you value determines the principles by which you measure your behavior. Sound principles are based on your rock-bottom assessment of what is right. They represent your perception of the way things ought to be. And that perception is based on your values. If you want to be truly happy, direct your efforts toward bringing your life into harmony with your values, the way things ought to be. Applying your talents without reference to your values and principles is like using your car's accelerator without touching the steering wheel. It may take you far and fast.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.